calendar, which is, I don't know if you know what today is?
Halloween.
Okay. That's not quite the church calendar, but everybody knows it's, anybody else?
Reformation Day.
That's right. Today is a Reformation Sunday. And almost 500 years ago, next year is the 500th year anniversary of Reformation. And God has in history blessed the world, blessed the church, God's people, through leaders, servants of God. And today we remember that as called to worship, I chose the text from Hebrews, where it talks about the cloud of witnesses. So I'll read that and we'll pray and then begin our worship together. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 says, "Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith." Let us pray together. O God, gather us together on this Reformation Sunday, that we may celebrate the witness of our forefathers and foremothers, and the courage that gave birth to the Reformation. Lord, teach us how to honor the saints of God in ages past, as well as in our present days. May the conviction of your grace written on their hearts be on that forms our own faith today. Lord, inspire us in the continuing reformation of the church and of our lives, and be present to us in your word, in your grace, and in your power. In Jesus' name we pray, and our God's people say,
Amen.
Let's all stand and sing to the God who will worship the King.
We are the ancients of faith.
We're welcomed into this space by God, by His grace and peace, and we're going to take a moment to pass the grace of Christ to one another as we greet one another. So turn to neighbors around you and say, may the peace of Christ be with you, or God's peace, or whatever you want to say. And let's greet one another. Even when it's hard, you will never leave me after all. So we're going to sing that together as our prayer to God, and then I will go into time of prayer. So.
Walking on the water.
So we're going to go into time of prayer together, and this morning we do different things during the time of prayer, and I thought I will do a little bit different, that I'm going to, during the prayer, give a little pause after different topics. I'm going to go through, we're going to pray through what's called Acts, you know, many of you know, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication, which is intercession. This time is a congregational prayer, and which is a prayer of God's people. And obviously, I don't know what's all going on in your life, or what you're thinking about for as things to pray about. And so I will meet some of the times with a prayer that I will offer on our behalf. But I will also invite every one of us to pray to God, and God hears you. Even the Bible says, even our groans and sighs, the Spirit knows. So whether you open your mouth and say something, or you just say something in your heart, God knows what's going on in your heart. So I will leave those times for just brief moments of silence that you can pray to God. You know, the prayer is one of the best ways, the privilege actually, we have as Christians to talk to God, and God is God who listens and hears our prayer. So there are so many things that we can pray about today, but we'll take some time to pray. Also, I will invite any one of you. I'm going to kneel right here on the steps. If you want to, again, this is, you know, maybe you're sitting in the middle of the pew and you can't get out, but if you'd like to, either kneel where you are or kneel with me on the steps. As a whatever posture, you know, we pray with our heart and with our mouth, and we close our eyes just to be reverent before God, but also whatever physical posture you can do, whether you fold your hand or whatever, bow your hands, that's what we usually do, to express that God, I really depend on you. We are desperate to look to you, and the prayer to me is of turning our hearts to God. So whatever way that you know, is comfortable to you, I would invite anyone who would like to come and kneel on the steps. We're going to pray for the world today. We're going to pray for our nation. We're going to pray for our community, and we're going to pray for our community here at Calvary. So we're going to go there over. So let's go to God together. Pray. Lord God, you are an awesome God. You are a faithful God. You are beyond our imagination, Lord, as how you show your unending grace, your love. You never give up on us. You never give up on this world that's so full of darkness and sin everywhere we look. But Lord, you've been faithful in your promises not to wipe this creation like the flood. The Lord, you have shown through the rainbow, through the covenant, that you still love us even though we fail you. So Lord, we bless your name today. We bless your holy name. You're an almighty God. You're an everlasting God. You're the Lord of lords. You're the King of kings. And we bless you, Lord. Lord, as we come to you as your people, we want to pause and acknowledge our sins. We want to confess the things that we've done knowingly and unknowingly, Lord, before you, a holy God. And we take a moment now to look into our hearts and look into our community and even our church community, Lord, and we want to confess the things that we want to just lay out before you, that we have turned away, we have gave in to temptations, we did not love our neighbors as ourselves, we have not forgiven people
that we should have, even though you have forgiven us. So Lord, we pause this moment to confess our sins before you and ask for your forgiveness. Lord God, we thank you for your forgiveness, for all those who repent and come humbly before you, and you are just and faithful God, and you will wipe away all the sin that we confess to you in sincerity. And we thank you for the cross and for what Jesus has done on the cross to forgive our past, present, and future sins when we repent. So we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the forgiveness that comes through you from the Father. Lord, we also, as we come, we are so grateful and we want to give you thanks for many, many things that we enjoy each day, for the blessings that are there for us. We thank you for the life we have, for health that we have, that we can get up and be here on this day to worship you and to fellowship with our brothers and sisters. We thank you for the freedom that we have in this country to publicly acknowledge and worship you, and we thank you for so many things that we enjoy in our family, in our work, in our personal lives, and we pause again, Lord, to offer up our personal thanks to you, so receive our thanks, Lord. Lord, as a congregation, we want to thank you for Calvary Christian Reformed Church, this community, this family that we are part of. We thank you especially this month and the Appreciation Month for pastors. We thank you for Pastor Mark and for his wife, Marcia, and for their family. We thank you for his sacrificial and humble and just the faithful way that he serves you and exemplifies your love to everyone around him. And we pray, Lord, that you will bless them and you will just continue to lead and guide them to be Christ to others around them. And as they take this weekend off, we pray, Lord, that you bless them, as give them a safe journey as they travel, and bring them safely back to us. Lord, now we want to offer our prayer of intercession. There are so many things to pray about, and we want to pray for the world that we live in. We thank you that you love your creation and for many things that this world enjoys each and every day. The creation offers praise every day, Lord, just by being there. The trees and the beautiful season that we're in, just seeing colors change. Lord, we thank you that you bless us with your creation. But we also are mindful of the brokenness in this world, and we want to pray for different parts of the world that are suffering because of injustice, because of evil in the world. And we pray particularly today for reconciliation, peace, and peace in Syria. God of history, you know the struggles the families are facing in Syria. We pray for the divided family of Syria today, as brothers fight against brother, as sisters reject sister. May fear be submerged in compassion, Lord. May distrust be diluted by hope, as a vision of peace illuminates darkened minds and hate-filled hearts today, Lord. Lord, we also pray for the people in Mosul. Grant them wisdom in deciding whether to stay or to go. We pray that there might be safe places to flee for refuge. We pray that we might be people who model the hospitality that such crises demand in whatever way they would bring them to us. We pray for an end the long story of violence and upheaval in Iraq. May Western and Middle Eastern leaders work toward peace, Lord, and bless the work, all the work, movement toward peace. God, we also pray for peace in Syria too, that protect all who are attempt to leave the city during this time. We pray for those who have suffered unspeakable loss and whose lives have been altered because of the violence. Bring an end to this conflict soon, Lord, and move in the hearts of leaders to commit themselves to peace and to the protection of those who are vulnerable today. And we also pause to pray for other parts of the world that we know of. Hear our prayer, Lord. Lord, we pray for our country today. Your word says in 1 Timothy, I urge you, first of all, that petitions, prayers, and intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. And we pray today for the upcoming election and for all the candidates, that you may bless them according to your will, that your will be done in their lives, that where they are in error, you may guide and correct them, and that where they are wise, you may strengthen them. Stir in each of their hearts a love for truth, for liberty and justice, and for the common good. Heavenly God, we also pray for the millions of men and women who will be voting for our next president. Guide each one of us in discernment and knowledge so that we may vote wisely, and in doing so, that your will may be done. Turn our hearts from fear to hope, from hatred to love, from indifference to compassion. Lead us to be true to our conscience and our convictions without holding in contempt those with whom we disagree. Lord Jesus, you commanded us to love our enemies. Make us mindful that this extends to our political opponents as well. Give us the faith we need to trust in your love and your will, and the grace to act in accordance with your truth, your mercy, and your boundless compassion. Because, Lord, we know that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of the darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. So we put our hope in you, Lord. Our hope comes from the Lord, Maker of heaven and earth. And we pray, Lord, that you would keep us move forward as a nation and as a country, that we will learn to find rest in you, you alone, the Lord of lords and King of kings, and that we would, without a doubt, confess that our hope comes from you. Lord, we pray for our city of Wyoming, and we thank you for many churches in the city, many Christian brothers and sisters who are working for reconciliation, for healing, for justice, for common good. Lord, we pray that you would bless each and every one. We pray for One Wyoming Church plants all over our city and for their ministries. We pray for all other denominations, Lord, in this city, and pastors and Christian workers, Lord, that you prosper them and that you would bless their work. We pray for our civic leaders. We pray for teachers, both Christian and public teachers in school, Lord, that you would bless their work. You bless the children of our city. We pray for the vulnerables, the poor, those who are without home, and families. Lord, we pray that you would use us, your people, God's church, to reach out to them in love. We pray for our Calvary family. We pray for our leaders, for your council, for all the ministry leaders. Lord, you bless each one. We thank you for them. Fill them with your spirit each and each day. We pray for each ministry that goes on in this church every day. We especially pray for women at risk this week as they have an event on this Saturday, that they will, that would be a successful event, and it will bless those who come, and that you bless that ministry continually, Lord. Lord, we pray for those who are ill and weak today in body and spirit. We pause now to lift their names up to you. Hear our prayer and heal them, and listen to the groanings and the pains, cries of their heart. We pray for those who mourn the loss of loved ones in our congregation, Lord. We lift them up to you right now. Lord, help us as a congregation and as a church here, that you would help us to be true witnesses of Jesus Christ in our individual lives, to love our neighbors, and to show our Christian love to our co-workers and our family members, that you would make us shine in this community, to be a shining light for Jesus in the darkness. It would be the salt that helps to stop decaying corruptions or darkness in the city, so that your truth can go forward and your gospel be lived out through our lives. So Lord, as we continue to worship, we pray that you would hear our prayers, you would speak to us through your servant, that you would receive our praise and our offering, that we may truly be the people of God today, and that you would give us true rest in God, and that you would bring refreshment to our soul as we worship and as we spend this day. We thank you and we honor and bless you once again. We pray all these things in Jesus' name, and God's people say, Amen. This time we've got some announcements. As you can see, our pastor Mark and John are out of town. So we're all filling in, and Peter will give some announcements.
So John emailed me on Wednesday and asked if I do announcements, and I said no, but here I am, so let's go. All right, so this evening we have a joint service at Lee Street. It's tonight at 5 p.m. if you'd like to go. We have a sign-up sheet in the back for Thanksgiving lunch. For any of those who would like to come, you can sign up in the back. If you have questions, you can ask Pastor Mark or John. They'll probably be here next Sunday. We have an event at our church. It's Women for Women at Risk. It's this coming Saturday from 9 to 4. So if you'd like to sign up or learn more about that, I think there's information on the back. This will be our second year of doing a leadership vigil retreat. It'll be Monday, November 13. You can talk to John or an elder if you're interested in participating. I'm going to go off the script a little bit, and I'm going to ask my Gems girls to stand up. Come on, I know you're there. All right, so this Wednesday we're doing a badge night, and then this weekend we are going to the cadet camp out for our weekend retreat. And so in order to do fun things like that, we do sub-sales. So right now we are doing a sub-sale. So if you would like to buy subs or soup, find one of these girls, and they'll get you all set up. Thanks, girls. At this time, we will be having our offering. And children worship will be dismissed.
Oh,
chance to hear God's word from one of our guest pastors, and today we're going to hear from Pastor George, and come on up. It's great to know about what's happening in our church, but there are so many other ministries in the city of Wyoming, and Pastor George leads one of those ministries, Good Connections, and it's part of what's called One Wyoming Church Plants. And some of you know that I work with a denomination in Home Missions, and when I look at pastors like Pastor George, they are my stars, my yay, go people. And I'm so eager to hear what God's doing around the new ministry called Connections, and so I welcome you to our public.
Thank you, brother. Wow, this has been something already this morning. So far, I think Katie, the announcement person, is my favorite. Wow, I'm just impressed because I saw her hand shaking just a little bit, but I'm telling you what, her voice did not. She was awesome. Well, thank you for inviting me to your church and to your pulpit this morning, and I want to tell you a little bit about Connections, but I want to do it within the sermon, and so let's pray and read God's word. Father, we are so thankful for your word. It just never ceases to amaze us. It's just like any other book. It's black letters on white paper, but when we read it, something happens deeper inside of us than when we read anything else. And we are touched and we are blessed. And so this morning we anticipate that same blessing as we read as we explore the words of Jesus. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ from Luke. An argument started among the disciples as to which of them would be the greatest. Jesus, knowing their thoughts, took a little child and had him stand beside him. Then he said to them, "Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me, for he who is least among you all, he is the greatest." This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Notice that this passage starts out with a simple phrase. An argument started among the disciples as to which one of them would be the greatest. An argument started amongst the disciples. Wow, we don't argue anymore, do we? No. But just in case there's a couple people here that argue, I want to talk about that briefly. It doesn't say, I read this passage. I normally read a passage 50 times before I write a sermon. Just read it over and over and over, and I'll make a few notes, but I'm not designing a sermon, just making some observations. And one of the observations that I made was an argument started among the disciples. That struck me, an argument started among the disciples. But what was the argument about? In my mind, the argument was about who is the greatest. But the scripture tells us that the argument was about who would be the greatest. And I just couldn't even imagine what other arguments that the disciples had that were not recorded. If they're already arguing about who would be the greatest, not who is, but who would be. It started with an argument about something that hadn't even happened yet. It's not about who is the greatest, it's about who would be the greatest. But, and this amused me, I don't know if it amused you, but this amused me, and I just thought, this is way too much. But then it kind of drew my attention. I thought, what are some of the things that I argue about? What are some of the things that I think that I would be and start an argument about? You know, I'm at Connections. It's a brand new church start. we only have about three of us that have much of any church background, and the rest do not. Which I do every year, I list the topics that people bring to my attention that they would like to hear about. And so we put them at tables and we give them sheets of paper and we just say, go at it. And we try to spark the conversation. We'll read some passages of scripture or we'll name some things that we talked about before. But the number one thing that they always list is talk about God's love. How much God loves us. These are folks that do not know love. These are folks who live tough lives. There's an after-school program that Connections began in the school, the group of leaders, which I'll talk about at a little more length in a few minutes. But the kids thought that it would be a good idea to have an after-school program to help their friends with self-harm issues. Just show of hands, do you know what I'm talking about here? You have an idea. I did not. I'll be honest with you. When I first came to Wyoming, I did not know what self-harm meant. I do now. And they have a lot of friends who are dealing with those issues, up to and including suicide. And so they wanted to start an after-school program. And so they came into the school and they talked to the school, and we met with them, and within just a few days we had an after-school program. It was amazing. But their biggest problem with these mostly non-church kids is they did not feel loved. We had a meeting after last year. The kids wanted to continue meeting. And so we met at the building that Connections uses on the campus of Grace Reformed Church there. And we gathered around the table and we had some snacks and we talked. And someone posed this question. One of the kids did. Who here does not feel loved by one or more of the adults in your home? That was the question. Almost all the hands went up. 19 hands went up. They didn't feel loved by one or more of the adults in their home. I was the only hand that did not go up. There were 20 of us there. Myself. And 19 kids. Can you imagine? Maybe some of you here this morning are in that same situation and you do not feel loved by one or more of the adults in your home. I pray that you do not, but please talk to me afterwards. We need to talk about the love of God that overcomes all those obstacles. So what the disciples, what Jesus, what Luke is telling us here is, we need to get out of our arguments, because the number one reason that non-church people don't come and don't want to come to church is that we argue too much. We're hypocrites. We need to set aside our arguments and focus on love. We are called hypocrites, I think, because we talk about love, but often we don't, or sometimes, at least, we don't show it. We don't walk it. We don't walk that talk. We can be judgmental, and the reason why I'm saying this, you know, if you injure your finger, you are keenly aware that when you point that finger that there are three pointing back at you. I've become more aware of that with this little thing on my finger than at any other time. And so I point those fingers at me. So one is your way, three is my way. Because as I talked it over with my wife, I don't know if all pastors, preachers do this, but I talked to my wife about what's going on in the sermon and kind of asked for her thoughts and what do you think. And more times than not, she said to me, you got three fingers pointing back. Let's show the world this love that we talk about, that we read about, that we're supposed to exemplify this love. It's not exercise judgmentalism. You know, we don't have to agree on anything to be kind to one another. Amen? That's exactly the truth. We don't have to agree on anything. God wants us to be known by our love for each other. I have my cell phone out because I kind of pay attention to a clock, but so far that clock has continued to read quarter after seven. Just protecting me. God wants us to be known by the way we love each other. You know, there's a song that will know that we are Christians by our love. Not how wonderful an argument we put together, but by our love. And kids especially don't like to hear arguments. In fact, when they hear their parents arguing, what I hear from them is, my parents are going to divorce. That's how they read arguing. Divorce, separation. The reason why I'm talking about kids in this passage is because of connections makeup. We were, all of us who started new churches in Wyoming, we were taken by surprise. We were surprised in various and many ways. At Connections, the idea that came to us through prayer is that we thought we would set up an exact neighborhood, that we would go door to door and we would talk to people. And we would stay within those confines. So for us, we have Jackson Park on the east. And then on the north, we go two blocks to the north. And we go three blocks to the south. And then to the west, we go three streets. And that's what we call our neighborhood. It's kind of like a parish that's all laid out for us there. Not that we are strict about that, but that's our main focus. And so when we went out into the neighborhood, we were really surprised. Well, the first surprise that we had walking through the neighborhood and talking to people was that we saw cars parked out on the streets. And we thought, that's strange, because the demographic study showed, and of course the demographic study can't be wrong, right? The demographic study showed that each of the homes there are like 2.4 bedrooms and 2.5 kids, and generally mom and dad. And so we saw two stall garages, but cars just lining the streets. And we began to find out that what was going on there is that there are not just two adults in most of those homes, but there are three, and many at least. And they're all wage earners, but they're all working for minimum wage in general. Not one making $42,000, as the demographic study showed, but three working at minimum wage, making that amount of money. And so three cars, two stall garage, one parked on the street. And we were surprised by much of that. And as people began to gather at Connections, we were surprised again, because there are so few people that were church. I mean, when I'm knocking on the door, the quickest way you can get me to stop knocking is just to say I already go to church. Because we're interested in non-church people. Unless they're at a church and they want to help us, that's fine. But we meet on Thursday, so we wouldn't even interrupt their Sunday worship. So when people began coming in, we saw broken families. And we saw kids without their mom and dad. And then we were surprised. I knocked on the door one day, and I was totally unaware of this, but it was a group home. I saw a woman came to the door, and I talked to her about Connections, and I think I've shared my Cracker Jack story with you before. But I tried the Cracker Jack story this past summer, this famous Amos cookies. Not bad either. no fries inside, though, you know. So, well, I went to their door with Cracker Jacks, and I gave them Cracker Jack, opened it, and I had no concept that this was a group home. But we invited them, they came to our block party, and then they came to Connections, and then another group home started coming, and another. And so right now, our congregation is made up of, generally, one-third kids coming by themselves, walking to and from, and one-third folks from group homes, and one-third families, mostly broken. And so we began to focus on the kids' ministry. And so that's why I'm prompted especially to look at those passages that deal with kids. And this one deals with it in a powerful way. Jesus taking that child, as the disciples are arguing, who will be the greatest? And he takes that little child and he brings them before him, and he tells them that the least among you is the greatest. Wow. I'd love to work with kids. Working with kids is just, to me, it's just awesome, because they are genuinely excited about what goes on at Connections. This past week, I brought a young man with me to the classes meeting, and he spoke about the change in his life through the Connections program in the schools called the Harbor. And he spoke briefly about the purpose of the Harbor, which is to help kids with self-harm and self-esteem type of issues. And he said, I was one of those kids, and I needed to be there. And I began to listen and to talk with others. And I when I heard the good news of how much God loved me, it changed my life. And he closed his two-minute talk at the classes meeting by saying, if not for the Harbor, I would have been one of those kids in school who harmed themselves, and maybe to the point that I wouldn't even be here today. That was his testimony. God loves you. The number one topic in our sermon theme request. And that's what these folks are clamoring. They want to know how it is that God can love me. Me, who is not even loved in my own home by all the adults. So we need to put ourselves in that position where we represent love, not argument. A couple of programs that began through these kids, because we recognize one-third of our congregation is kids, and the adults that are part of Connections are working all they can, and if the boss comes to them at 4:30 and says, I need you to work a couple hours over, they're going to work a couple hours over because they need that job and they need the money. And so leadership training for adults is kind of difficult. Only about half of them would be there at any one time because of family or work or other issues. So we continued it, only we just do it once a month now. And then we instituted a youth leadership program. And it was amazing because we just designed it to meet once a month, and the kids are like, can we meet more? Moses is the only one that probably laughed at that one, because the rest of us are just like, how does this happen? So we moved to twice a month, and then now we meet every week. The youth leadership team meets every week. And we open with devotions about leadership, and we talk about leadership principles, and then we talk about the areas of the church that they can lead in. And the adults set the parameters for them, but I'm telling you, they tackle it and they get into it. I mean, kids are just, it's just amazing. So we handed things over to them, like the setup for everything we do, and the cleanup. And they put lists together, and they have responsibilities, and they have names plugged into all that stuff, and they take it seriously. This past summer, when we were doing block parties, there was a church that wanted to come and observe us so they would, you know, see what block parties are all about and see if that worked for them. And they, the adults that came, there were two men that came, and they were watching the setup, and the one turned to me, they had talked to themselves, and then the one turned to me and they said, "You have 33 kids here. There is no way we can have 33 people to sell a setup." And I had no concept of it. I mean, for block parties and for fun stuff, especially outside like that, the kids just, they rally and they bring friends in and they work with them and they get them to get involved like that. And I guess I had never counted them, but I said, "It'll happen, brother." You know, we just started out with like three or four kids, but it began, God just worked, and with prayer and with persistence, this can happen with you also. You can attract kids. And you know, I look at this facility, you have no problem attracting kids. I mean, you got that awesome gymnasium. You got, I mean, everywhere I look is just so many convenient things. People are having coffee out there before and, I presume, after worship. And just the gathering places that you have here. What a wonderful opportunity. So let me share you a couple of stories with kids before we get into the three things that God wants us to emulate, that we can learn from kids and apply to our life, so that we can be the person that God wants us to be. We were meeting, the adults were meeting in the parsonage. I lived in the parsonage at Grid. And we were there, and we were having our monthly meeting, and there was a knock at the door. So we went to the front door, and it was a half a dozen kids. And from Connections. And they said, "What's going on here? Was there a meeting we didn't know about?" And we're like, "Well, this is the adults." And adults! And so I heard the adults murmuring behind me about maybe we should invite them in, you know, snacks and treats. So we said, "Okay, we've got some stuff. You're welcome to come in. We can chit chat. Let's say a prayer for you. And then you can head out." So the kids came in, saw what we do, and they said, "We got to do something like this too." So we do that every once in a while. In fact, we had a Reformation Day. Is that what it is? Pastor Moses, Reformation costume party. We had a good time last night. And one of the moms I had never met, her son attends the Harbor, but we invited the Harbor kids to come too. And his mom came up to me, just like we were friends forever, and gave me a big bear hug, and he said, "I am so thankful that your church is doing this." It was awesome. I loved it. So anyway, kids want to be a part of the program. They love to be a part of the program. One of the things that I feel kind of bad about is I live right there on the campus of Grace, and then when I have to study, you know, I for sure, and it's usually at night because we have programs during the day, then I go to the office at night, and especially in the summer, frequently there'll be a buzz, you know, of the security system, and I look in the camera and they're in the little tube there, and it's kids. "Pastor George, we saw your truck here. Can we come up?" Now, I like to think that they're there to see me, but see, I keep these candy bars under my desk, so I think it's for the candy bars. But in any case, they come in, and I have a hard time getting my work done, you know? So I feel bad about that, because, I mean, I want to spend time with them, and they need somebody who cares for them, you know, to spend time with. And so I kind of scoot them out as soon as I can, but I really feel bad when I know I've got to get a lot of work done, and I take my computer and I go up to the office and I leave my car at home because I don't want the kids to see it and know that I'm there. And then I feel bad when I see, especially when I see them walking by and looking up just to maybe see if I'm in my office. So That's the kids. There are so many passages about kids in the Bible. Then little children were brought to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. Jesus says, let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. There's a familiar passage to probably most of us here. And Jesus comes into the city, and he's riding on the donkey, and people are laying their coats, and they're putting palm branches out. The triumphal entry, that we call it. And Jesus comes into the city, just like that, raising up. A ruckus is going on. And the whole city asked, who is this? And the crowd said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. And then he comes in the temple, and you're familiar with what happens there. He comes into the temple, and he sees the money changers who are cheating the people out of money as they change it into the currency that they can use there. And he turns over the tables. And he comes into the temple area. And then when he gets there, the children start shouting Hosanna and praise to the King of Kings. Now, all of this stuff has happened. And the leaders of the temple saw him coming in triumphantly, flipping over the tables. The whole city's in an uproar. And what do they rebuke Jesus for? The children are too loud in the temple area. Did they get upset about, or at least in their conversation with him? Did they blame him for the turning over of the tables? Did they blame him that the city's in an uproar? No, they blamed him because the kids were too loud. Wow. Jesus saw this. And he said to them, Have you never read from the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise? You lifted up kids in us. In verse after verse and passage after passage about kids, I tell you the truth, Jesus said, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. So we need to change. And we need to become like little children. And you know some of those traits in your mind. The traits of awe and wonder. Those are some of the traits that Jesus wants us to have in our relationships with God. Three I want to bring to your attention. One is a child's humility. This little child that was there and Jesus took when after they had argued about who would be the greatest, he brought this little child next to him. And it exemplified it. It's a child's humility. The child doesn't wish to push himself to the forefront. They can learn that later. But when they're children, they're humble. It's only when a child grows up and becomes a part of the competitive world that they begin to lose that. But the followers of Christ must learn to humble themselves before the Lord, so as James puts it, the Lord can lift us up. Child's humility. And second, very simple, it's just dependence. Child depends on adults. Dependence is natural to the kid. A child gets that he can't face life by himself. Gabriel was about, my son, our son Gabriel was about 7 years old, and we took him to Disney. And the place that we were staying in Disney there, we thought he knew fairly well. And so there was one point where he was going to go back to the hotel room and then come back and meet us in the dining hall. And we didn't see him for about an hour, probably. And when we finally found him, we just kind of imagined that he found Mickey somewhere and he was spending time with him or something. But he walked. And he was frightened. And this kid that was beginning to show some signs of independence and self-sufficiency, he was a mess. And to this very day, when we talk about that trip to Disney, he will bring in how frightened he was as a little kid that he was lost. Kids are dependent on their parents. That's how we should be with God. We should be dependent on God. And then there's the trust of a child. I grew up in the middle of nowhere, Indiana. And we trusted Jesus. You know, when we would play football, and the UPS driver would drive by where we were playing. And he'd stop his truck, jump out of the UPS truck, and run over to us. And we had a drill. He would pick the team that he was going to be on. And then he would be the quarterback. And the play was always the same. Everybody out for a pass. And so he would be the quarterback. And he'd get the ball, and he'd go back, and he'd throw it. And then while the ball was still in the air, he'd run back to his UPS truck. And then cheer whoever caught it and take it off. Now, trust is a little bit different today. I think if the UPS truck stopped and the guy got out and started running toward a bunch of kids, it would be a different reaction. Unfortunately. A childlike trust. To trust, that's why we refer to God as our parent, our father. Because that's how we should trust God. These are the qualities that God is looking for in us. And those are the folks who are the greatest in the kingdom. He said to them, "Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." Amen. Father, help us to turn from wanting to be the greatest and exercising that desire in so many worldly ways. Help us to learn to be like that child that you held before you. And help us to love each other as you have. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you. for inviting me to this place. It's been wonderful to share with you this morning. And I'd be glad to meet with small groups and talk more about the Ministry of Connections or whenever you would like me to. I'm free on Sunday morning, so if Pastor Mark calls in at 8:30 and says I'm sick, you can give me a call. I'll be there. Probably not in my suit, but we'll have fun together again. Thank you. Hear these words from our good God. Our people of Calvary, go forth in peace. To love and serve your God and to be a little child in this place and in front of our God.